arguing loudly as to which one deserved to enter first. I should be first, proclaimed one man, because I tried to make men wiser. I was a professor. Oh, no, 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 no. I think I should be first, said another. I was a banker. I tried to make men richer. Well, finally, St. Peter turned to a silent little man standing modestly to one side. And what did you do? Oh, I just tried to make men laugh. I was only a clown. Well, upon hearing this, St. Peter permitted the clown to enter heaven ahead of all the rest. For he knew nothing linked men to the angels so strongly as the divine gift of laughter. Tonight we salute the givers of laughter, those golden-hearted healers of the human spirit, the clowns.
Be a clown, be a clown, all the world loves a clown. Show them tricks, tell them jokes, and you'll totally stop with my folks. Dress in huge baggy pants, and you'll ride the road to romance. A butcher or a baker, ladies never embrace. A barber for a ball would be a social disgrace. They all will come to hell if you can fall on your face. Be a clown, be a clown, be a clown.
Clowns have always been special. Their gifts of laughter have been rewarded by a grateful world for centuries. But every year, on May 31st, one clown is honored above all the rest. On that day, clowns from all over the world gather at the Holy Trinity Church in London to pay homage to the clown who was born over 200 years ago. The greatest clown who ever lived, Joseph Grimaldi.
Clowns and clergymen are very similar, or perhaps ought to be similar. Perhaps they ought to be more similar than they are very often. You see, I think clowns, like clergymen, they're non-productive, they're non-economic, they don't contribute to the gross national product. They make comments about life. They make statements about life and death and love and pathos and humour. All the sort of intangibles and important matters that I think are most important in our lives and are essentially religious in its deepest sense.
Clowns come to honor Joseph Grimaldi on this day because to them he is the clown of clowns. To understand the life of Grimaldi is to understand the very nature of what it's like to be a clown. Joseph Grimaldi was born in 1778. He was only two when he appeared on stage with his father, who was an actor. Like many stage children of that time, he played the part of small animals. He was sometimes treated like one. Grimaldi's father forced him to learn all the theatrical arts from juggling to swordplay. His father was a harsh master, which was just as well, as it prepared him for the physical hardship he would have to endure as a clown. It was a brutal age, and the comedy reflected this. Audiences demanded that humor be violent, bawdy, and slapstick. Comic sword fights sometimes blinded clowns. Mock battles too often crippled them. Despite the hazards of his profession, little Joey grew up to be the most popular clown in Europe, and every other clown was compared to him. He is remembered for his innovations. He was the first to paint his face, changing it into the clown face we know today. He created a new clown costume and invented a clown character he called Joey. Grimaldi completely transformed the clown character for all time. He delighted his public by mocking royalty. He was the hero who championed the poor and oppressed and stood for democracy against the upper classes. He was the rebel, challenging all authority, doing things on stage that would land the common man in jail. After more than 30 years of swordplay and dangerous stunts, his body could take no more. Weary and despondent, Grimaldi knew his career was over. Desperate for help, Grimaldi, using an assumed name, consulted a doctor. The weary clown told the doctor, "I could take an interest in life again if only I could laugh." When the doctor heard this, he replied, "Oh, you can do that, sir. All you have to do is go and see the great clown, Grimaldi." At the age of 43, Grimaldi appeared on stage to say goodbye to his audience for the last time. Thousands of people came to say farewell to their friend, Joey. To this day, nearly 150 years after his death, clowns the world over are called Joey, in honor of Joseph Grimaldi. The year that Grimaldi retired, a clown was born in America who was going to change the face of comedy again. His name was Dan Rice, and he invented a brand of political humor that fit with America's rugged pioneer life. A country boy given to wisecracking and Cracker Barrel humor was his style. Dan Rice would ask his pig, Lord Byron, what he thought about politics and the administration of President Zachary Taylor. The pig would reply with shrewd political insight. The audience loved it. He was America's first political satirist, as popular with politicians as he was with the public. In 1868, this esteem led him to run for president of the United States. Dan Rice didn't become president, but he did receive the greatest tribute ever paid to any clown. He was the model for our own Uncle Sam, a symbol that survives to this day. In the one-ring circus, talking clowns felt close to the audience. However, by the end of the 19th century, that consummate showman P.T. Barnum had introduced the three-ring circus. The rapport between the talking clown and his audience was over. With the disappearance of the one-ring circus, a new breed of clown was born. By the late 1800s, many of them were in burlesque, which at that time was family entertainment. There were no strippers or risque sketches. The clowns were the stars. Stars like Ed Wynn, Fanny Bryce, Leon Errol, W.C. Fields, Weber and Fields, Eddie Cantor. When burlesque became too off-color for the family trade, the clowns moved on. Most of them went uptown to Flo Ziegfeld's Follies, those great extravaganzas that starred the most beautiful girls and the funniest clowns in the world. One of the most celebrated clowns who flourished during the heyday of America's great clowns was a woman, Fanny Bryce. Although she was a superb singer, it was her mobile face that made her a clown in the great tradition. The star of the Ziegfeld Follies for 14 years, she became America's best-loved comedienne. Popular creation was that lovable brat, Baby Snooks.
Oh, Snooks, what is it?
Blow this balloon up.
Oh, all right.
Bigger.
There you are.
Bigger.
Yeah, there, that's as big as it'll go.
No, no, bigger, bigger, bigger.
Oh, all right.
Fanny Bryce had more films based on her life than any other comedian. More important, her freewheeling comedy style opened the door for the talented women clowns who followed her.
A
Of all the clowns who graduated from the vaudeville and burlesque stage to Ziegfeld's Follies, none was more inventive than Bert Lahr. His hilarious facial and vocal shticks survive today in the comedic equipment of just about every comedian in every area of the entertainment world.
I love the wild, wild west. I love the blue skies above it. I love the cows and the prairies and the acres. Boy, I love it. I'm a highfalutin, rootin' tootin', double shootin', wild coyotin' cuss. Boy, I love it. I'm tired. I need a change. I'd love to be alone, home on the grange, where the deer and the cantaloupe roam.
You were.
Now, no slugging, Lulu. Remember, no slugging.
In 1910, another great Ziegfeld star became the toast of Broadway for 15 years. His name was Bert Williams. W.C. Fields said he was the funniest man he ever saw. But he's best remembered for the song he made famous.
I ain't never done nothing to nobody.
Before Bert Williams, only whites were permitted to perform in minstrel shows. In blackface, they did parodies of black performers. Even the leads in Uncle Tom's Cabin were played by white people in blackface. Bert Williams was able to break that barrier. The impact of his talent was so great that he became the first black performer to play first-class theaters in the white world of the vaudeville circuit. Respected by his peers as the greatest comedian in the country, he was still prey to the same prejudice encountered by all black people of his time.
They used to call me, Snake Hips. Look out, I'm coming at you.
Bert Williams fought back with the only weapon open to him, his great sense of comedy. Eddie Cantor tells the story of the time that Williams went into a St. Louis bar and ordered gin. The bartender was reluctant to serve a black man. He frowned and said, "I'll give you the gin, but it's going to cost you $50 a glass." Without hesitation, Williams whipped out his wallet, took out a $500 bill and said, "That's fine, give me 10 of them." Bert Williams was one of the last of the great vaudevillians. By the time he told his last joke, a new medium was finally coming into its own, motion pictures. Not only nurtured the great clowns of the stage, but developed many of their own, like Ben Turpin, Harold Lloyd, and Harry Langdon. But the towering giants of this new golden age of comedy were Buster Keaton and Charles Chaplin. It is said that in every country of the world, at every hour of the day, people are watching, laughing, and crying at the films of Charles Spencer Chaplin. Chaplin became the most famous man in the world, earning at one time over $2 million a year. But like most clowns, Chaplin shared a common heritage, a tragic childhood. Chaplin was born in London on April 16, 1879, at the end of the Victorian era. His childhood could have been a chapter from one of Charles Dickens' bleakest novels. His father, a music hall performer, died of alcoholism at the age of 37. His mother, an actress in vaudeville, became incurably insane by the time he was seven. Charlie and his brother Sidney were placed in the Hanwell School for Orphans.
At the age of 9, he got his first job with a show business troupe called the Lancashire Lads. One job followed another. He became so well known, he was included in the Who's Who on the London stage of 1907. At 18, Chaplin got the break that changed his life. He became a member of the Fred Carno Fun Factory for Clowns, which was booked to play the United States. On the morning the ship arrived in New York Harbor, Charlie amazed the company by leaping to the railing and shouting, "America, I am coming to conquer you. Every man, woman, and child shall have on their lips the name Charles Spencer Chaplin." In 1913, Charlie was lured to Hollywood by the reigning king of comedy, Mack Sennett, and became part of the Keystone family. His screen character was created while making his second film called Kid's Day at the Races. Chaplin remembered that one day Sennett told him to go to wardrobe and put on a comedy getup. "Anything will do," he said. Chaplin threw together an outfit that was a study in contrasts. Baggy pants, tight coat, small hat, and large shoes. Remembering that Sennett wanted him to look older, he added a tiny mustache. From the moment he put on the costume, Chaplin understood the character perfectly. And the little tramp was born. His career took off like a skyrocket, and before long he was writing, directing, and producing his own pictures in his own studio. Out of his studio flowed one masterpiece after another, all marked with Chaplin's magical perfectionism. Great classic scenes like this one from The Gold Rush, he combined pathos and comedy in a way never seen before or equaled since. In this film, the little tramp pits himself against the elements in the Klondike Gold Rush of 1898. Big Jim McKay, played by Max Wayne, and Charlie are trapped by a storm. As the storm increases in violence, so does their hunger. To keep from starving, Charlie cooks and eats one of his shoes, sharing the leather dinner with Big Jim. Chaplin combined all the arts of the clown, from the circus and music halls to vaudeville. Out of this remarkable heritage came the most universal comedy creation in screen history, The Little Tramp. Sharing center stage with Chaplin was the great stone face, Buster Keaton. He was born Joseph Frank Keaton in 1895 and literally crawled on stage for the first time when he was 9 months old as part of his parents' vaudeville act. Everyone always wondered where Buster got his famous deadpan expression, which formed the basis of his screen character. The ad for the Three Keatons read, "Maybe you think you were handled roughly as a kid. Watch the way the Keatons handle Buster." Buster was the talk of show business. He played the part of the living mop. His father would toss him around the stage, into the scenery, the wings, and often into the audience. In order for the audience to think this was funny, Buster later recalled, his father told him to, quote, "freeze his puss." In 1917, Fatty Arbuckle invited Buster to play a scene in his new film, Coney Island. Keaton fell in love with the new medium and began to develop a unique style of his own. His character became so popular that it challenged his closest rival, Charlie Chaplin. Like Chaplin, Keaton demanded and got total control of his films, which he produced and directed himself. He soon had a studio of his own. He was famous for working out elaborate physical gags. His long years of being knocked about in vaudeville made him the screen's most agile acrobat. Props on a grand scale, using visual gags of monumental proportions. His comic inventions achieved a surrealistic quality as Keaton moved through them with his dreamy, impassive face and flawless body movements. Buster's daring almost cost him his life. In this scene, unbeknown to the film audience, Buster was secured to a 16-foot log by a thin, invisible safety line when accidentally the wire snapped, throwing him into the rapids. He narrowly escaped being battered to death by hanging onto some overhanging branches. Meanwhile, the camera kept rolling. Every comedy had its chase scene, but none ever reached the epic scale of this one from his film, Cops. Keaton hired 1,000 extras to play cops for this chase scene to end all chase scenes. In 1927, Keaton and Chaplin were the reigning kings of comedy. Then the talkies came in and everything changed. From the moment Al Jolson was heard singing Mammy in The Jazz Singer in 1929, the days of the great pantomime comedians were numbered.
I hope I'm not late. Mammy! Don't you know me? It's a little crazy. I walk a million miles.
Overnight, silent clowns had become obsolete. Hollywood began a massive search for performers who could speak as well as act. W.C. Fields withdrew his life savings and drove across country to Hollywood. And Hollywood hasn't been the same since.
Okay. Wasn't your fault. I can fix that. No harm done. No harm done. Got a mole?
Yeah, I've had it all my life.
Mm-hmm. Well, won't have it anymore. Have you ever had this tooth pulled before?
No.
This won't hurt you much.
Yeah. Get it out. Get it out.
W.C. Fields never saw any reason to compromise with a world he felt was out to get him. He declared open warfare on the authorities that plagued his miserable childhood and adolescence. He was born William Claude Dukenfield in Philadelphia on April 9, 1879. His father believed in harsh discipline, and he punctuated every order with a smack in the face. A crisis was reached not long after Fields' 11th birthday. He'd left a small shovel lying in the front yard, and his father stepped on it. The handle flew up, inflicting a painful blow on his shin. He hopped around on one leg, cursing. Then, seeing Fields laughing, he picked up the shovel and rattled it off the boy's head. Fields swore to get even. He hid in the stable, and when his father came in looking for him, Fields crowned him with a large wooden box. And then he walked off down the road, never to return. To keep from starving, he embarked on a life of petty crime. As a result of beatings by other street kids, his nose became permanently red and misshapen. He discovered he had a natural ability for juggling, and he started practicing 16 hours a day. Confident of his talent, Fields left Philadelphia determined to become the best juggler in the world. By the age of 21, he was a success, receiving rave reviews across America and Europe. In 1914, he went to work in the Ziegfeld Follies. After 20 years of being billed as a silent humorist, he added jokes to his act for the first time. He made his debut in films in The Pool Sharks, which was a sketch he had been doing on stage for 12 years. The trick table was one he designed himself. The film was not successful, so he went back to the Follies. It was 10 years before he appeared in films again. This time in a filmed version of his stage hit, Poppy, directed by D.W. Griffith. When the talkies came in, Fields was in his glory. Now he could write his own screenplays. A friend said, Bill had only one story. It wasn't a story at all, really. Just an ugly old man and an ugly old woman and a brat of a child. With these three basic ingredients, he could attack every aspect of the so-called American way of life.
Hello, mister!
Hello, little boy.
Did you give me the dollar?
Oh, it's a little girl. Hello, little girl. How old are you? 5 years old.
Will you give me a dollar to put in my bank?
I'll give you a dollar to put in your bank if you'll sing me a song.
Give me the dollar bank.
You're more than five. Go on, get out of here.
Come on,
slam. Who's Craig? Get away.
I don't care. I got $50 in my bank already.
You have $50 in your bank?
Yes.
Probably has a pin sticking in her. Is he standing in a hole?
No, he's just a little fella.
Send him in, I'll fix him.
This way, please.
I can't find his mouth. Hand me that stethoscope, will you? Thanks. Will you say ah, please?
Ah.
Again?
Ah.
Again?
Ah.
I almost had it. Again?
Ah.
Huh?
Ah.
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 That it is.
Ah. And a very pretty thing, too.
There were no sacred cows in the world of W.C. Fields. The very values others idealized and sentimentalized, Fields criticized. In doing so, he became not only the father of modern comedians, but of modern humor itself. The humor of the man who broke all the rules is as timely and funny now as it was during his lifetime. A different kind of humor was created by the Marx Brothers, three zanies who seemed to be totally out of control, out of touch with reality, doing all the things the rest of us would secretly like to do. Julius, Adolf, Leonard, Milton, and Herbert. Better known respectively as Groucho, Harpo, Chico, Gummo, and Zeppo, were born in New York's Upper East Side near the turn of the century. They were the sons of Sam Marx, a tailor, and Minnie Marx, one of the most extraordinary stage mothers in show business history. The brothers always gave their mother, Minnie, all the credit. Groucho said, "I was kicked into acting by my mother. And if I hadn't been, I'd now be on relief. I've never taken a bit of success for granted. When it came, I was always sure it wasn't going to last." Never have a comedian's fears been so unfounded. The Marx Brothers have delighted audiences ever since.
How do you like it? It's the same from my second act.
I don't like it.
If you don't like it, we'll put in another scene. You can have any scene you want.
I never knowingly hurt anybody in my life.
Hello, room service. Send up enough ice to cool a warm body.
Let's take him down the service elevator.
I won't have him insulted. He'll go with the regular passengers.
Well, someone might see us.
Oh, what do you got there?
Where? Oh, there. One of my actors. He's passed out from the excitement. I need him for the third act and look at him.
You'd think he was dead.
Yes, wouldn't you?
The zany comedy created by the Marx Brothers caught on, ushering in other comedy teams like the Three Stooges and Abbott and Costello.
Where do I put it?
No, no. Take the stand.
I got it. Now what'll I do with it?
Clancy's pool room. Sit down.
I'm a victim of circumstance.
Who are you hitting? Be quiet.
Sammy, no.
Don't bother me.
Sammy, you're not going to kill anyone.
Don't hold me back.
Don't do that.
Somebody's got to get it. And when I get this mad, somebody's got to get it.
Wait, I don't care what kind of money.
Don't you give me that lie. Listen, you've got money over there without no argument.
I'm not going to...
Anarchy was the comedy order of the day, and the order prevailed until the emergence of Laurel and Hardy, who represented a gentler kind of humor.
Well, how about a nice cool drink?
When Hal Roach formed his Roach Comedy All-Stars, Stan and Ollie were a vital part of the organization. They appeared in the same films, but not as a team. However, they would often do bits together. And gradually, their curious mixture of personalities began to attract attention. Hal Roach made their bits longer, and before anyone realized it, by 1928, they had become a team. In the years that followed, they made over 100 films.
Doing with that cushion?
Well, I keep on bumping my head. See?
Give me that deed.
Oh.
Stan Laurel and Oliver Hardy were modest men. They had absolutely no idea how loved they were throughout the world. When they went to England on tour, they were mobbed by crowds of people. Stan said, "We both cried at that moment because of the love we felt coming from everyone. For the first time in their lives, they realized they had become household words. A miracle that never ceased to amaze them. They appreciated each other both as comedians and persons. If anyone asked Ollie about comedy, he would always say, ask Stan. When Stan Laurel watched their films, he said, I only watch Ollie. He really is a funny, funny fellow, isn't he? The affection that was the hallmark of their work was the quality that made them, for over 25 years, the most beloved comedy team in history. In 1957, Oliver Hardy died. 8 years later, he was joined by his beloved partner, Stan Laurel. All the great clowns from the golden age of comedy are gone. With them went a special kind of humor. We will never laugh in quite the same way again. When we lose a great dramatic actor or actress, we are diminished, for they take with them the power to move us to thought and feeling. But when a great clown goes, he takes something far more precious, laughter. Buster Keaton. Charles Chaplin. W.C. Fields. Joseph Grimaldi. Fanny Bryce. Burt Williams. They've all given us the gift of laughter. In exchange for their laughter, we've given them our love. And if love is the highest human emotion, it would suggest that the clowns have a higher purpose, one that goes far beyond entertainment. We've all heard the old saying, the Lord never sends us more sorrow than we can bear. Well, perhaps he sent us the clowns to make the bearing easier.